no substitute for actually using the detail and the tools to be able to do the clash detection. If you're a designer and you're working in BIM, you don't use clash detection tools. Design coordination and clash reviews. This is BIM without information, but from that perspective, it is extremely valuable. By visually flying through the model and engaging stakeholders in the process, clash detecting the clashes appropriately, doing it in zones, not coming up and finding 10,000 clashes and establishing how good you are as a model manager. That has no benefit. Clash where you're actually working and take the benefit there. Data creation, this is where the trouble starts. We're trying to get data out of the model. We're talking about scheduling, we're talking about quantities, object libraries, what goes in the object, where do you place it, do you put all the information in the actual object, or do you actually just put placeholders in and link it to a database? I'm probably going to suggest you have some placeholders, you link it through unique identifiers into a database. Your record model has all the information you need to have to meet the two. Not maintain the building, look at it as a record. I'm suggesting your FM model is a stripped down version. And then you link that into a middleware solution, and that will link into your asset management solution. That's currently what I'm looking at now, and it's actually making me think about how I've actually approached it. So I'm actually looking at it from the end user perspective. So in 2016, we're looking at level 2 BIM in the UK. It's all about data. I think the UK is starting to lose a little bit of confidence in what it's doing. If you look at recent surveys, they don't seem to be thinking they're getting the message through. They don't seem to be achieving what they set out to achieve. I think it's because they're trying to do more. I think it's because they're actually looking at the information side, and it is difficult. And I think they will actually go backwards in a bit. Don't be discouraged. That's what it's all about. Take the benefits of 3D. I'd suggest Qatar start straight away into doing 3D models. The protocols will sort them out. You'll have a debate about level of delivery or level of development. Just put it in the contract. Have a debate how you want to do it between the client and the contractor. The contractor's BIM execution plan will confirm back to the client what he wants. Just sign up and get over it. Just get on with doing BIM. So in a model in this project, you can define room and space requirements, the environmental parameters, so there's tools and the software out there. There's Codebook and there's DOFIS, which is a rather good tool which comes from Scandinavia. Offsite manufacture. Offsite manufacture is quite important in the UK and places like Australia because of the cost of the labour base and the de-risk the project. So you've got to look at your own sphere and where you work. Is offsite manufacture as important in Qatar as it's important in China? I suspect on China with the underlying labour issues. 4D modelling, it can be quite sophisticated with the practicalities of the planner. Same with 5D, we will get 5D, the cost of it is getting so much better. But I think if you use it intelligently and you actually start attributing cost to the model and you design to cost, so I think using BIM and utilizing BIM, you get that stakeholder engagement. And the days, I think, when you actually sit in front of clients and start hacking away at the design, trying to keep the cost down, and trying to involve the engineer and save money, I think they're going to disappear because we'll have made intelligent, informed decisions as we go through the process. FM, early engagement in the model, it's critical that we start to look at the FM side. We are producing object libraries, we're putting a lot of data in the objects, and we don't really need to have it there. Just want placeholders in the object, so you can actually link it to a database and through a model viewing tool, can then start to use it. So I think let's start putting the information in the database. So I'm suggesting that we look at Simple BIM, and that's the solution there for Qatar. I think it would be wrong not to have a picture of the Harbour Insane up there, everybody else has. It's about doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. What we're trying to do is to drive efficiencies through a project with them, and it's not working. We've just got to think in a slightly different way. Why adopt BIM? There's numerous reasons why you would do that. You get better teams, you get more involved teams, you get higher quality work, less advertising on the project, contract engagement early on, so there's a lot of positives to be taken out of that. It's difficult to quantify the benefits of BIM through case studies. It's such a new and evolving industry, and it depends on which group of years we are in. There are figures out there which suggest that you few projects meet the original budget. My company working on the Sydney Opera House, writing the FM plan for at the moment. The Sydney Opera House was, I think it was 12 times over budget. So I think what BIM allows you to do is to engage in projects and do it in a more intelligent manner, and essentially I think it de-risks the project. So why have we got such good adoption of BIM in the UK? I would suggest government had a big hand to play in it, but I think a lot of it was down to the procurement group. It was private finance, it was PFI hospitals, it was building schools for the future. These are all large projects over 3 or 4 years. They required multiple design teams. The client wanted to de-risk the process as government as a client. Contractors embraced it, and it allowed teams to assemble and learn by doing. So if you're on phase one of a project, you assembled the team, you got used to BIM, you talked to our protocol software, and we started learning on phase two. And by phase three, the designers have clearly exceeded the expectations of the contractors. So in summary, large projects where you've got them out here, it's about innovation. It's about doing something different. I think actually if you just do something different, think about a different way you're going to do it, you'll get benefits on your job. Without actually doing BIM, if you think about the different processes, clients wanting BIM is a big driver, especially if it's government. But you need to be BIM capable teams. You need ready-made library content. It's important that you assess the capability of your team and then look at the objectives for that project. Don't describe the objectives and select the team that can't do the job you want them to do. So it's about early and informed design decisions. We've seen this slide where at the front end you make more impact on cost, at the back end you can't incorporate design changes. And that goes to the client as well. The client, if he starts to impact on a lot of changes at the back end of the project, you start to lose control of the design. So we've actually said, right, we're going to do BIM. So here's a picture of me looking a little bit like Einstein, but hopefully with a slightly better hair tuck. And it's about doing things differently, but don't overcomplicate the process. And that's what's starting to concern me about the number of protocols. The gentleman over there mentioned the amount of protocols that are coming at people now. And I think while people are trying to come and get a grasp of the technology, having protocols coming in, 3 or 4 a year, have to assimilate that information and make sense of it. It's very difficult. The protocol I looked at was American Institute of Architects. I looked at that in 2007. It's a very simple document, about 6 pages. It talked about modern element authoring, it talked about LOD, level delivery, level development, or level of disaster, whichever way you looked at it. And that migrated across to Europe. People picked up on it. We've also got COBE coming in across, and the UK government have taken COBE, which is slightly difficult, I think, and it's a spreadsheet, and we've managed to overcomplicate it. Nobody's actually identified how much COBE will cost for the industry to implement, and I think that's really important that you actually, when you're asking people to do something, let them understand, what the impact is on the cost. So then we took these protocols and they went down, gone down under, we've got this failure to develop in BIM. And then I'll kick it back with their version of it. We've got BIM MDPOs, which is looking at the prefabrication site. And it's all about putting your own flag on it. It's about localizing BIM for you. And I think be very careful what you adopt. I wouldn't suggest for 1 minute that Qatar should adopt COVID without really looking at the impact it has. Suspect Kobe, it will dilute it, the impact it has on the industry through the benefit of software, and I think we'll also simplify it. It's a good structure, I think it's slightly over complex at the moment for your average BIM engineer. So we've also got people in Hong Kong, in Singapore, looking at BIM, different drivers, the politics of BIM are different. BIM gets you on, there's no doubt about it. There's a company in the UK who spent about £1 million on a team to try and get BIM, and their head ratio on projects went down from 1 in 7 to about 1 in 1.7. So look at people trying to sell you BIM, but make sure they can evidence base it. There's a lot of smile there. There's a smile beside Scandinavia because they've been doing BIM for years. Unfortunately, a lot of the documentation can't be understood by great people who speak other languages anyway. So we haven't managed to take the benefit of that. But take a look at what these guys have done. It's pretty good. And you've got tools like Solidity Model Check, which comes out of Scandinavia. So here we are. We're in Qatar. I think it's about you guys making your own decision on what you want to do. I'd like to think the roadmap and the implementation is less than 3 years. I think you've got to look at the case studies and look at the benefits and work with the supply chain and try to help them get through this bit exercise. So it's about documentation and protocols and learning by doing. You know, these people are all looking outwards. They're actually working in their own silos, which I think is pretty typical of BIM in a certain extent. And let's reinvent the wheel. Let's reinvent it in a way that it doesn't work. Because that's what's happening. I think what we've got to do is accept there are some protocols out there that are simple. Just use them, adopt them. You can probably save about 12 months of the implementation plan. So the most important document for me is the employer's information requirements. That's how we set up the data and the model exchange. From an FM point of view, that's really important. Then you've got the BIM execution plan, and that basically is in response to the employer's requirement. So if you have that debate where you actually say, this is the employer's requirement, and you feedback as a contractor what your execution plan is, you're actually then going to tease out what the nuances are around your delivery document. Scoping documents are very important. Drill into the detail, look at the level of detail, get into the words. Are you going to model scoping? How are you actually going to do it? So a week looking at the level of detail in the model will save you months on the project. There are many templates out there regarding BIM protocols. It's important you look at how they can do. You establish what the capabilities are, then you actually look at what the content is and what you're going to do for your project. Determine your handover strategy, what the content is. It's just a summary slide of execution planning, interoperability, and people have to work over that. Model naming conventions are very important. You need to do that at the outset of the model planning. So, protocols, level of delivery. This is a document I followed, the Medical Institute of Architects document 2008. Fantastic document, really simple, but 7 pages. Yes, you all go and read it, and then read the work documents, which are 700 pages. Because this is the basics of what you've already seen. This slide is actually what for writing architecture part-time, probably doing that. And it's looking at the different stages. You can apply a model at any stage in the project, and I think that's the time when you should do it. Do it from the outset. Simple massive models, simple costs. Are you going to prefabricate? What are the drivers? Are you doing FM? Get the client engaged in the process, because ultimately the client is the person that will take the benefit from it. Model management is extremely important. If you don't do model management right, you tend to start working in silos. I've actually seen projects where working in BIM is worse. Because people actually will start off in the model, and they won't exchange models for 6 weeks, and all they're doing is passing problems down the line, and people end up doing some redesign. It's about your implementation plans. Flash detection is extremely important. Specific design reviews, set aside a time every 2 weeks to do your design review. 4D, look at the benefits of 4D. Don't do a fancy 4D model to start the project and then not use it for the rest of the project. If you generally said, yeah, that was it. But if you have regarding our act of what we do before the EU meeting, we need to put the necessary people in place to achieve that. As built models and record models, I think they are actually, that is what they are. The as built model probably contains too much information, especially when we're looking at COVID data drops, and the FM model could be stripped out of that. So if you don't do it right, you actually end up with additional risk and missed opportunity. You end up with unclear BIM duties, duplicate effort, inefficient information production, you certainly get decrease in communication on your project. Why won't we get a supply chain model? I think if we sort the contract out, it's a collaborative contract, get the supply chain model, and you actually get the benefit of these individuals, tacit people who actually build the project and can bring an immense amount to the construction and design process. And let's make sure that the model doesn't become redundant after design. If you don't do it right, you just end up with your, you end up with an absolute missed opportunity. So this is my roadmap. It's pretty simple. It's about sitting around the table, agreeing what your governance is, agree your standards and sort of close them out. You will be fighting over the resource, certainly in Guitar. I don't believe there'll be enough people here to do what we want to do if you actually start to build most projects in it. And make sure your resource can actually do the job you set out to do. Implementation is critical to get the engagement. Training an individual and collaboration can allow them to fly through the project. It's immense. He will actually bring huge benefit. It also allows you to get better planned stakeholder decisions. So we're going to build a commission, and then we're actually going to lessons learned. And lessons learned, that's a difficult place to go, because you will actually make mistakes along the journey. Just get over it. Have a look at your governance. Look at how you measured, what the team did, what did they set out to do, can you do it differently? Don't make the same mistakes on the next project. I'm not even going to talk about level development. I think it's too emotional a subject. Certainly don't want any questions on them. But the only one thing I will say is, while you're actually putting your object libraries together, think about the fact that you've got to keep them relevant and up to date. So whilst you build a library, you're going to have to look at that library and modify it in 12 months, 18 months. So this is an object library. My company actually builds object libraries for MBS. We tend to put an awful lot of the object library, and I've suggested that from an FM perspective, you only need to have placeholders in the top left hand corner. Information that goes into the object library. One gentleman actually mentioned that, you know, there'll be information for the constructor, there'll be information for the designer. All need to have their own placeholders there, but from an FM perspective, you'll probably end up using a database and a middleware solution to link with the theoretical members, these are people, I suggest, who scope jobs but not part of the contract. I suggest that we all need to take the pain and work on projects. Because if you're going to write documentation, I've actually written protocols. And I've written them usually out of necessity because a commercial guy suggested that we're going to do BIM and we didn't actually create what we're going to do. So I think what we've got to do is, can we actually achieve what we're writing? Because clients will listen to the experts and they will ask and they will clamour for what the experts are saying. Model managers will actually specify the scope. And we've got the technology now which will actually be able to interrogate every model we do. So even if you don't want to share your model, it will get out there and somebody will start to use it. So this is a myriad of documentation that's actually coming out of the UK. I think that was meant to be me sort of saying embrace the model as opposed to people running away from it. You know, that idea of modifying the plan of work after 60 years and achieving the way we do it. We've got Passive in 92, which has got version 2, which is about how we integrate the model and work with it. 3 is to do with maintenance, and 4 is going to be with COVID. Basically, BG6 is a really good document regarding how MVP people work. The next phase is going to be the digital plan of work. which is going to be done by the UK government. I think that will take about a year to do, and they're actually out scoping the operation of that. I'll not touch any more than Kobe, other than there are data drops out there. The one thing I've got about Kobe, and I've been difficult to have, there's no data told me much it's going to cost to do it. And I think if you're actually a contractor and you're engaged with the process, I think that's the least you should know. So I think if people are asking people to use Kobe, there should be that indicator there. And I don't actually see a lot of benefit of people using Kobe from an FM perspective, using that spreadsheet to run the FM model. So I think what we're really saying here is evidence solutions would really make people buy in. That said, I like the structure of how it does. I like how it gathers information. And I think the visualization checking and mapping tool will take the pain out of Kobe. So I think what we'll see is Kobe in a sort of hidden environment and middleware tools will start to assist you. So it's a bit like your iPad. A lot of what goes on behind you will actually be done by software providers. Past 1192, I'm one of the few people who started actually to read that from cover to cover. Figure 20. And I look at it from a contractor's perspective, and I look at it, I try and understand what we're trying to ask our people to do. And, you know, it's a game changer for such private equity. It's a huge game changer for the UK industry. As a designer, you've been asked to be dimensionally correct and coordinating design in your model. You've actually been asked to put class-free designs in place. I think you've got a responsibility to make sure the contract produces working drawings in a manner without major redraw. I don't think you'll ever get a class-free drawing from a designer. I don't think that's what you should be doing. Objects and assemblies, you've got to be accurate in regard to size, form, and function. I think that's going to suggest that we actually do more. So the MEP contractor or designer who's doing planting service highways, horizontal ones, and he's not doing good for the rest, I think the journey's over for them. I think past 1192 is asking them to do more. We're also looking at the model, the asset, the handover, before or during construction, the information that needs to be attributed to commission data. RFIs, snagging. So again, this is a very, very accurate model. So I think it's a very onerous thing that I think if we start the journey and we look at the information side, there definitely will be huge benefits from it. So in essence, great concept. I think will we achieve it in 2 years' time? Step too far. So we're actually talking about laser scanning. When laser scanning a model, laser scanning is easy. Actually producing a model from it is slightly difficult. You actually need cost. On a major project, you probably spend about £1 million assembling the model. Why would you want to add that value to them? It's all about saving money. So I suggest you only look at certain areas of the laser scan set areas and take the benefit from that. So BIM in an international context for me, this is a personal journey. I kept my passport busy. It's allowed me to travel around the world for 2 or 3 years for that. I'm really thankful to BIM for that. It was industry-led when I left the UK. The simple BIM in 3D. I worked in India with an outsourcing provider. And I believe the journey there was more of learning about outsourcing engines. But I think the point I would make about the Indian market is it didn't particularly use it in their own domestic market at the time. When they worked with people who were licensed in the UK, there was issues regarding code compliance. And I think that worked for me when I worked in Canada, about me understanding what the drivers were for the Canadian business. I went to Canada, was there for 9 months on the bed, didn't see any evidence of any real brake penetration. I worked with some architects from the States, they were doing negative evidence. We're starting to do simple scheduling. But I think examples I've seen from what we do in the States is we're actually getting deep dives into the technology. We haven't got the broad brush approach. Australia was a joy, just purely because it's a people country. Doing BIM on the beach is where you should be. Complex delivery. The marketplace has MEPs split up to 3 or 4 different disciplines. So you're coordinating about twice as many models. There is no mandate in Australia. And you have this very scenario where you can, some people say, you know, why would we do that? And they've got other states which are fully embracing it. Hong Kong, I'm seeing academic leadership in Hong Kong, and I'm actually seeing leadership through outsourcing. So we're not actually seeing designer penetration there, and we need to see more of it, and otherwise we're not going to get the benefit of it. Going back to the UK, it took a totally different twist on me with all the different protocols in place. And I remember the journey when I started the journey, and got a huge amount of benefit from not having the governance there. So again, I would just say, you know, throw your hat at the wall, get on the deep end. You will learn by doing. I think it's got slightly complex. I think it's got necessarily complex because of our own information. People are struggling with it. Qatar, what a fantastic opportunity you've got. It's a buoyant market. It can be market driven. Academic rigor is necessary because you have to train your people, you have to scale your people, and accept what is good. And the skills that you have here, and learn by doing. The one thing that's absolutely missing from all of this is no KPI, no key performance indicator. You actually benchmark what a model looks like. You can actually categorize a model and say that model's got a score of 40, and we benchmark against it. I think, from a legal perspective, BIM's pretty easy, because if you don't know what we're producing, how can you actually compare? So I think, well, we've got to start looking at the KPI. If you start to get that KPI data from each project, what you can then do is look at the combined learning from that. You can take it to your academic institutes and they can start to try and fix it for you. Try and train the people in what the common solutions are. Don't forget supply and trade. Don't forget supply and trade. And don't forget tradesmen. Tradesmen add massive benefits to putting in the UK. Personal summary. It definitely was a risk for me to have to do because I didn't know what I was doing. We sat around tables and we consulted and made choices on software. We actually were in protocols. But I really looked, before I did it, I looked out and see what was there. And again, I referred to the references of the news. I have despaired. I've despaired more. I've sought global knowledge. I've learned a lot today. And you learn more about the cultures of integration and how people come to the technology. Fantastic to come to an event like this and see the shared knowledge. It's great. It's great to be in a room like this. Training is critical. Training people in it. Embrace change or run away from change. It's your choice. I think people make a conscious decision to do BIM or not to do BIM. But what I suggest is whatever you do, if you look at the software, if you look at the protocols, look for everything, great solutions out there. If you're going to look at Kobe, look at solutions in the back. Learn by doing. And I certainly, after all the trials and tribulations, I wouldn't go back to working in 2D. I just can't imagine going back to the world yet. And BIM is the best thing that's happened to the construction industry in many years.